So now we are going to show that we show that there exist mu and mu prime. Suffices to show that. So if I can show that there exist parameters mu and mu prime such that max So if I can show that on this instance either mu or mu prime, so when I say nu, this is collection of this Gaussian distribution, when nu prime is collection of this distribution, if I can be able to choose this Gaussian distribution with this parameter, certain parameter, so that the max of this regrets happens to be larger than c square root kt, then it kind of implies my regret lower bound, right. So now let us start looking into what are these parameters. So for mu, I am going to set such that this mu I is going to be delta for I equals to 1 and it is going to be 0 otherwise. Yeah, so this example we are running through Gaussian case. Yeah, but we also said in the statement that it is sigma Gaussian, it should be fine. Okay. Yeah, if it is sigma, it's fine for sigma sub Gaussian, it all automatically implied for bounded one, right? So I am looking for one banded instance now where the first term has mean delta and others are all have 0 mean. Okay. So how I have chosen this delta, we have not yet specified, just for time being I just assume that the delta is something which is positive, strictly positive, and other terms has 0 mean. Now for this bandit instance, clearly arm 1 is the optimal arm. Okay. Now what is the regret is going to be? Its regret is going to be so number of rounds, in that you just pull whatever the number of times you have played the optimal arms. So this is the regret of the this is the regret you are going to get for this instance. Is that correct? So let us say whatever is n1t denotes what? Number of plays of the arm 1. So these are the one which are this many in expectation, these many rounds do not give any regret. Other than this place, all the plays t minus this many rounds, they are going to you are going to incur regret, and each one of them is going to add a regret of delta. So this is a total regret if you have this problem instance. Okay. Now we have total in number of rounds to be capital T, let us say. Then the claim is there should be at least one arm which would have been played less than T by k number of rounds, is that correct? Yeah, no? By what principle? Vigenère's principle. So we are just going to apply that. So one of the arms which are like not the optimal arm, there should be one arm which is going to be at least played less than T by k number of rounds. There exists I such that expected number of So if this is not true, the total number of places is going to be greater than t. Okay. Now based on this sum, so whichever is that I not equals to 1, we are going to now what? Yeah, okay, so let's say that's right, I have excluded I equals to 1. If I have included everything, this is fine. Okay, so if I say this should be correct, right? So just forget the optimal arm. So this is the remaining number of plays you have, and from that you are going to play, and there are from the remaining k minus 1 arms. So I am just going to be upper bound it further and just take it k minus 1. Earlier one was correct, but it was loose. Fine. Okay. Now we are going to now construct the second bandit instance as following. We are going to say now construct yes. So what I am going to do is RT sorry mu j pi prime. So the new set of parameters I am going to define like mu j for j not equals to I, and then I am going to define delta j for j equals to I. So what we are just saying is, so there should be at least one arm I not equals to 1 for which this upper bound expected number of poles has to be t k minus 1. Let us say for that arm I am going to make now the mean reward to be 2 delta, others I am keeping the same. Now what has changed? Earlier the mu, my mu look like delta 0 0 0 0 0, right, and now my mu prime looks like this delta 0 0. Let us say this ith one is the this one whatever I got, let me call it as 2 delta like this. So what is the optimal arm in the first bandit instance and what is that in the second bandit instance? Ith arm, right? It has. Now the question is, the two instances differ only in the ith arm. The two optimal arms in the two scenarios are different. Now the question is, can I set my delta in such a way that even if my bandit instance it happens to be 2, but my algorithm thinks it is still bandit instance 1 and ends up selecting my arm 1 most of the time. If I can do this, then I have made my algorithm make error, right? I will make it error most number of the times. So now let us see what will be a good choice of delta here. So here on it will be too much hand waving. Now this is just like we will make the things bit more formal. So now right now assume that So just you notice that the upper and lower bounds, they have a factor n delta square, right? N into delta square. Suppose I set my delta n. So I had this delta such that so okay, before I write this, let me. So when I wrote this expectation here, so this expectation is induced by the interaction between my policy and the environment. Okay, that is going to induce the environment here is defined by nu. So the interaction between nu and my policy resulted in that induce this expectation here. Now for this bandit instance, what is the expectation, expected regret? Expected regret, suppose if I continue to apply the same policy on this also, first term is no more optimal, but that is going to cause me a regret of delta factor, right? Because it is off by delta. The optimal is 2 delta, R1 is delta. So the regret by the place of R1 is going to be this much. And then there is no regret from the I term in this bandit instance because that is the optimal. And other than R1 and R j, everybody is going to cause me regret. And what is that amount? J not equals to 1 and I expected value of nj t and 2 delta. And this quantity has to be at least delta times expectation of T. I just written the expression for regret that I am going to incur on the bandit instant. Now, suppose if I set this delta to be, let us say, 1 upon expected number of n I. What is this expected number of place? So, and here what is E here? This is, I am going to put E prime here because this expectation is induced by interaction my policy pi with environment nu prime, whereas this expectation was induced by interaction of my policy pi with environment nu. Now suppose whatever be the expected number of pulls I had with respect to my original or initial bandit instance, right? Let us say this was the number of expected number of pulls. I know that this quantity has to be upper bounded by t upon k minus 1. So this quantity, let us say, so what I have basically made is, suppose if you ignore the expectation here, just do some hand waving and just take this to be simply the number of pulls of I term, then what I am basically doing is delta square times number of pulls of I term, I am just setting it to be 1. That is, I am making the factor n delta square big enough. That is close to 1. Okay. Now, if I can do this by choosing it in such a fashion, now you can again go and see that on even this instance, I can come up with a similar upper and lower bounds I had earlier on the sample mean of a Gaussian random variable, and you can see that my algorithm will fail to identify this as the optimal arm with this, and it may still end up choosing on this instance this as, and it will confuse this instance as this instance and think this is the arm 1 is the optimal arm most of the times. So that again will bit make it more formal, but that is the idea. Like if we can formally argue that by the choice of this delta, even on this instance, it is likely that my algorithm will still continue to think that it is this instance and plays arm 1 most of the times, that means it is making a wrong choice, right, in terms of the optimal arm. And even if that is the case, in that case by this choice, let us say then we expect, because my algorithm got confused between these two instances, the number of times it would have pulled is going to be close as expected number of times that would have pulled under bandit in the second instance. So in this case it is clear that, let us assume that the algorithm is making eventually figuring out R1 as the best term. Now with the appropriate choice of this delta, there is still a possibility that even in this instance this will continue to make a bad, yeah. No, again it is like I just restarted and gave you a new bandit instance. Once I start algorithm, I am not going to change the bandit instance, okay. In this case, because even in this instance my algorithm got confused thinking it as this instance, then it is going to spend most of the time on the first term. We are going to expect the expected number of pulls on bandit, the expected number of pulls that I am going to see with the second instance is almost going to be same as that I am going to have it in the first bandit instance. Now I think we are more or less done, okay. Now first we are going to consider the case expected number of pulls is going to be n by 2 t by 2. If this is the case, so earlier we had demonstrated that RT of pi nu is what is equals to t plus expected number of pulls of now in if this is the case, then this is nothing but what, this is t by 2 and delta. And what is my delta, we have set it as k minus 1 by 2. So this is like some, yeah, k minus 1 root kt by, sorry, t times k minus 1, right. Okay, now consider the second case where has happened to be hertz equals to then we have also argued that this guy RT pi nu prime we have had a lower bound here, this lower bound here. We had shown this is nothing but delta expected value of n1 t, but then using this approximation here, this is nothing but expected value of n1 t, and this will give us this will give us again the same thing, right? Again, it is going to be half of. So, this quantity, this one I am going to replace it by t by 2, and delta from that, this is going to be k t times k minus 1. So, for both the cases, we have this lower bound, and now we have our, now if you are going to take max over these two instances, now we have that the regret is going to be order square root t k minus 1, and there is an half factor here. So, this is just like very heuristic top level arguments we have. So, what is happening is we are able to come up with when we are just arguing that if at all we have this instance where my algorithm is going to confuse it with the other instance, then it is possible that my regret is going to be order square root tk on these two instances. Okay, now we have to make this bit more formal. Okay, so for this we need some information theoretic quantities and some bounds based on them. I am just going to introduce them in today's class, and in the next class we will try to go through these steps formally. So, how many of you know already entropy? You know or no? Half, you know half. Okay, now we are just going to some definitions. So, suppose let us say if you have a probability distribution P, okay, on k alphabets, we are going to define entropy of this distribution as expected value of pi log 1 by pi. So, those who know this entropy, can they tell what is the meaning, what is the operational meaning of entropy? I mean, we know that the amount of information contained is inversely proportional to its probability, right? Like suppose if an event is going to happen with probability 1, is there any information contained in that? You already know that is going to happen, right? If an event is very less likely, then maybe like information contained in it's more, right? Because if something rare happens, like that's the big news, right? So in that way, the amount of information contained is like inversely proportional to its probability, and also and that way, I mean, you can also give an interpretation that if something is more frequent, and if you want to assign let us say some codes to it, you are going to assign larger code or shorter codes the things which are going to occur very frequently. You want to assign shorter, right? Because it is appearing more and more times. The one which are going to appear less frequently are going to, you will be forced to assign larger one, because you need to distinguish, right? If all the small length codes are taken by the quantities which are happening frequently, then what remains is the larger one you are going. In a way, the if you want to like encode something, you want to encode something which is more frequently with less code lengths, and the one which are happening rarely with larger code lengths. So in that way, if you are going to think this log 1p as the length to code a message, let us say, then this is going to give you basically the expected length of the code, and information tells that this is the minimum average code length you need if you want to recover the message correctly. Okay. So fine, this is for a given entropy. Of course, like I am assuming that all these quantities pi's have positive mass. Like if some pi is 0, this 1 by pi is not well defined, right? So I am assuming that all the alphabets I have here positive mass. Then there is a quantity called divergence. This also we defined in the last class. Now here I am assuming that both p and q are a distribution on the same probability space. Okay, let us say p and q are defined on the same probability space. Then divergence between these two quantities defined as log pi by qr. Can I write it in terms of entropy? So in that case, it is like, if I have to write it in terms of entropy, it is like minus hp, then log in a way. So if you are just going to give the same interpretation that we just gave here, so if you are feeling that, let us say some messages are generated according to probability distribution pi, but you misinterpret that and you assume that they are generated according to distribution qi, right? The true generation is pi, the messages, but you somehow got confused and think that they are generated according to another distribution qi. So then the length you are going to assign is log 1 by qi, but the true one happens to be pi, right? So this is still the expected length you are going to code those symbols, and this is anyway minus the best you could have done, right? This is, you are not doing that good, right? So this is the best you could have done, but this is not the best you could have done. What do you think, this difference has to be positive or negative? It has to be positive, right? Because this quantity is going to be larger than this. So this quantity divergence, we already discussed when we discussed the proof of KLUCB, that using this for at least Bernoulli case, we can get a very tight upper bounds. Okay, and now in general, this divergence is have other names like Kullback label divergence, KL divergence. In short, it has some nice properties. It kinds of measures the distance between two distributions, even though it's not a true metric though. Okay, so it's not a true metric because it does not satisfy the transitivity property. Okay, let's see now. I'm now just going to state one result and then we'll stop, which is going to become handy to us. When we are going to state our proof formally. By the way, like if P happens to be Gaussian normal with Gaussian with the mean mu1 and sigma square, and Q happens to be another Gaussian with parameter mu 2 and sigma square. So notice that the way I have defined here, this is assuming that these are discrete probabilities, right? Like they are, these probabilities defined on discrete random variables, but this random, this distribution could be on a continuous random variable, in which case I have to appropriately define this, okay. So that definition is, has something bit involved, it depends on the Radon Nikodym derivative, but just let me write it here. This is defined as log of dp dq zero otherwise. So it is defined as, this should be p here, sorry. So this is defined as dp by dq of omega d of p omega here, this integration. So this is okay, right? P is absolutely continuous with q. So that means I just want to make sure that this is well defined by making sure that this guy is in the denominator, I do not end up with zeros, right? And whenever this guy, and also like these are, do not end up with 0 by 0 format in this. Yeah, I just recall what you mean by just absolute continuity. Whenever p is non zero, q is going to be non zero. Okay. Yeah, so if it is q is p is 0 when q is not 0, this is 0 by log 0, right? Okay, log 0 is,
we have a PI multiplier, take 0 log 0.
Yeah, 0 log 0 to be 0, fine. So we want as long as qi to be positive, no, non zero, pi to be non zero. No, no, there is a d. This is what we have, this Radon Nikodym derivative. This is dp by dq into omega. Let us not go into that, it is, yeah. Ah, it is a density function. Density, p and q are the density functions, but this is something different, okay. So let us. Let's leave it like this is another quantity, we have to slightly interpret in a different way, okay. So now if you have p and q, we are going to get it as d of pq, you can just compute this, we only need this, that is why I am writing instead of working out all this. This is going to be mu 1 minus mu 2 whole square by 2 sigma square. Okay, next theorem. Let P and Q be probability measures on the same that A belongs to script, A complement is omega omega A. So this is, we are going to not going to prove this, it says that if you have two measures or two pro, let us say probability measures P and Q on the same space omega and script F, then if you look at probability of A and probability of its complement, but with respect to another measure Q, that is going to be lower bounded by exponential of minus divergence between these two measures. Okay. So, what it is basically saying is, if you are interested in an event with respect to some measure P, then that not happening with respect to another measure Q, that so total sum is going to be lower bounded by like this. Okay. So, we will just going to use this result later to prove that. Okay, so let us stop here, we will continue it in the next class.